Hey guys, before we get into this episode, a quick update. I had some audio issues on my side and I don't know what caused it. I haven't seen it happen since. But the audio on Ceelows side is just fine. So I really wanted to put this out. I did everything I could to make it sound as good as possible on my side. But I do want to apologize in advance for the lower quality in this episode as a result, because this was a great interview that I had with Ceelows and I may have to just have him back on the show again, but I still wanted to put this content out for you guys as soon as possible. I've been pretty under the weather, but I'm trying to just push through and power through. So thank you guys so much. And I will see you all in this episode. Hello and welcome to FGC Philosophy. I'm your host, a philosopher, and this is where we focus on leveling up inside and outside the virtual arena every day. We do that by talking about topics and having guests in the show that I think are important to talk to or talk about. Today's guest is one that's been doing something pretty interesting. I like what he's been doing with his content. He's owned by Ceelows Online. He's been doing a tutorial sorts on I'm not going to say just Sakura, but that's the character that you focus on in this video. But he does basically a rookie to bronze and then all the way up to, I think, platinum right now, if I'm not mistaken.
Diamond. Yeah, we're good at diamond, yeah.
Okay, yep. And so I thought this was very fascinating. I love people who are trying to teach others how to improve at the game. And I wanted to have him on the show and talk about pick his brain to see what sparked it, digging into it a little bit deeper and see what else information we can learn from it. So welcome to the show.
Thanks, man. Thanks for having me. This is dope.
Yeah, no problem. So I guess tell me what got you started into fighting games?
So around, I want to say 2010, I think that's around 2009, 2010, my cousin showed me Street Fighter 4. I guess 2010 was like a year after it came out. I want to say a year. I'm not really too sure, but he showed me and it was my first fighting game that I gave some time into. I spent like, I want to say from 2010 all the way up to the end of Street Fighter 4 playing that game, but I never really spent or really invested effort in learning the game or getting better at the game. I kind of just played it with friends and lobbies online, and that kind of carried over to Street Fighter 5. So I guess you can kind of say I'm an 09er, old tenner, as some of them say. Then Street Fighter 5 came out, and I tried the first, I want to say, 5 months to get pretty decent at it, and then I took a break for about a few months. And then once I came back to it, I said, okay, I want to spend time actually learning the game instead of just playing with friends this time. Because I didn't really have that many friends playing since I used to play on a 360 with buddies. But this game's only on PlayStation. A lot of my buddies didn't really carry over to PlayStation. So I figured, since I'm not going to have those friends to play with anymore, I might as well learn a game and see if I can get involved in the community on Twitch and YouTube and whatnot. So that's kind of how I started off.
So who's actually your main character in Street Fighter?
So it started, I changed characters like five times. It started out with Cammy, then back to Ryu. Ryu was my main in Street Fighter 4. Then on to Balrog. That lasted only like 2 weeks. I can't play charge characters. Then went on to, from Cammy to Ryu to Chun-Li, back to Ryu, to then Balrog, then back to Cammy, to Akuma, and then Sakura.
Whoa.
Pretty all over the place.
Yeah. So what sparked your mind to want to even do this tutorial? Like, why did you do this?
So when I started, I want to say around 2017 is when I started getting into the Twitch community and getting involved with streamers and content creators and whatnot. And I noticed like some people, people started asking me for specific advice and tutorials. Like they asked me, what do you do to soccer tutorials and whatnot? And I definitely had the idea of it. I thought about it a few times, but I looked at the content that already existed. Anytime I want to make content, I want to see what's already out there and what I can provide that maybe some people haven't thought of yet. So I looked around and I noticed most of the tutorials on YouTube are it's a lot of either combo tutorials or tutorials on how to get started with the character, but it doesn't really go, or at least from what I've seen, it doesn't really go in depth to the extent that I want to go in. So I said, how do I make like a step one, step two, all the way to step 10 kind of guide? And I guess the way I wanted to structure it was I took piano for like I want to say a few months, a few years ago. And one of the best things you can do is get a teacher, because whenever you're learning any kind of instrument, you don't, if you try to self-teach, there's no real like step-by-step guide. You kind of have to figure it out on your own.
It's like no structure.
Yeah, there's no like layout for what you're supposed to do. I think that's kind of the hardest part of learning either a fighting game or like a musical instrument, is that what do you learn first, right? Because you can definitely learn the something that's I guess too far out of reach too early, that you don't necessarily need at the level you're at, and then it doesn't really help you level up, right? So this is where I kind of got the idea of Rook of the Diamond. Now, I didn't really have the rank structure in mind at first. I kind of just thought, well, how do I make a step-by-step guide that's easy for people to understand? And what is it going to be based off of? And the reason why I chose like rookie, silver, gold, and basic ranks is that that's kind of what most people are familiar with. I think it's fair to say that most people play online. I think the offline community is kind of like a portion of it, but a lot of people just kind of play for fun online and just want to learn online and maybe get to a certain rank and then just like stop after that. I've heard plenty of times where some people just want to get to diamond and that's kind of it. So I kind of wanted to cater to that crowd and give this kind of like step-by-step guide. So that's where I kind of had the idea for Rook to Diamond. But then I also thought, how am I going to lay it out for each rank? So that's why I started with the stream, right? I had like a Rookie to Diamond stream series where I would start from rookie and then I would only keep a certain game plan that I felt was needed for that rank and then try it out myself, see if it worked. And then every rank I would just add little things to it. So that's kind of how I started the structure of it.
Okay. Yeah. And I like the way you line that up, because a couple of key points that I think are worth noting is, in most traditional things, like I talk about karate a lot when I talk about fighting games, and you have a sensei. You don't just, you're not some dude just doing punches and kicks. That's like a brawler or a street fighter. You have some guy correcting you when you're doing things wrong. Unfortunately, a lot of times in fighting games, you don't really have a sensei or a music instructor giving you that structure and giving you that instant feedback of, hey, no, this isn't how you're supposed to do it. This is how you're supposed to do it. If you have sloppy input or sloppy execution, you can hurt yourself in karate, or you can hit a wrong note or have it mistimed in music. In fighting games, usually you drop a combo or you miss a whiff punch or something like that. But you don't really have somebody forcing you and pushing you in order to do that better. So I really like that. I've had a few people who play music, and I think that it's always fascinating seeing that transition from someone who plays music and then tries to learn fighting games, because they kind of naturally know to do certain things like over and over and over again. So another question I have is, what kind of feedback have you been getting from this tutorial that you've been doing? I know you streamed it and then you also turned that into content, which I thought was smart. But what kind of feedback have you been getting in person, like live and also on YouTube videos?
So I've definitely gotten a fair amount of good feedback and a fair amount of criticism. And the criticism is really constructive. It's actually something I've trying to implement for future videos or any future streams where I focus on showing the ropes, right? So some of the fair criticisms are, it's not a true Rookie to Diamond series because I have a lot more experience, right? Like a lot of the videos I have, all the matches, almost everything that's unsafe, I punish in the correct way. And that's mainly because I have the knowledge, right? I have like 1900 hours. It just comes with time. You just understand what to punish and whatnot. Now, I've mentioned several times on the streams in the YouTube series that that's definitely going to happen, is that I don't expect anyone watching the videos to have the same level of knowledge that I do. It's really just a matter of time when it comes to knowledge. But the idea I guess I wanted to come across is I wanted to leave certain things out. So like the Rookie to Diamond series, I don't use any V-triggers the whole time. And the reason why I do that is because I feel like there's already a ton of content people can go to for learning how to use V-triggers, implementing them into their game plan. I wanted to focus more on the fundamentals disregarding the V-triggers. And I feel like people can throw in the V-triggers for themselves, because you can kind of use them how you want, depending on what character you play and when you want to use them. I didn't want to give like this fixed idea of you have to use V-trigger at this point or at this rank, because I feel like with a lot of the players I played in certain ranks when I was ranking up in that series, a lot of people rely on V-trigger. And without V trigger, they kind of struggle. They kind of wait until they get it, and then that's when their game plan starts. I didn't want to teach the game in that sense, because not only is that going to hurt you later on as you start leveling up, you start playing better players. But if you're playing other fighting games, it also doesn't really help either, because this is an exclusively Street Fighter V mechanic, right? If you can't carry this into any other fighting game, so I really wanted to craft a tutorial that carried over to other fighting games, and while also helping you with Street Fighter. So that's definitely one good criticism, right? Is obviously anyone looking at the tutorial series and playing, they're not going to have the knowledge I have. So I wanted to make that really clear in the videos, and I think I did a pretty good job. As to how I'm going to change that for future videos, I think the only real way to do it is, like right now on my stream, I'm streaming the same Rook of the Diamond series, but with Jury. I know nothing about Jury. So I'm basically taking my own advice and applying it to a character I've never played, just to kind of like give this idea that you can still do this even with a new character. It doesn't have to be soccer or whatnot. I just chose soccer because I have the most knowledge for it. That's all.
That makes sense. Kind of a unrelated question, but one I'm personally curious about is, how are you starting back over from rookie? Are you just making a new account, like buying a new copy of the game?
Yeah, just a Smurf account on Steam. Yeah.
Okay, all right. I was wondering about it, because I'm like, I kind of want to do that for myself with like another character, because I'm learning new characters, and I play Fong primarily, and I'm a platinum Fong player, and I want some secondaries, and I want to take them from zero to... You know, well, basically what you're talking about, I kind of went up that into practice and start over with a new character and say, hey, I can play with just not a one trick, you know, I don't know, play any other games. And then something else you talked about with I like the fact that you don't use V trigger in your tutorials. I think that teaches some good habits and forces them to focus primarily on their fundamentals. And then I also like the fact that, you know, you focus on certain parts of the fundamentals depending on, you know, it's almost like a white belt to yellow belt sort of thing. It's kind of how I think about it. Again, going back to karate. And then one thing with the V triggers is something I hadn't thought about until I started learning other games, primarily because of my job. I started learning about Overwatch, and one of the terms they use is ultimate economy, because there's basically a super meter that builds up over time. And you don't want to just use it when you have it. You want to use it in the right situation. And in order to know when the right situations are, you kind of have to work on your fundamentals. They use different terminology, but I'm generalizing here. And I took that back to Street Fighter, and I looked at how I use my resources, and I kind of just threw them away a lot. And my V trigger, I never really had a strategy, particularly, you know, just if I have it, I try to activate it. And, you know, because I try to activate it in a very specific way, it makes it very obvious. You know, I try to sweep into V trigger activation try to do it for some sort of like 50-50, but like it wasn't really, it was pretty predictable against people who knew how to play against a character, knew how to play against me. So I think that's a really good point, because you kind of avoid building bad habits as you work your way up through the ranks.
Yeah, I think that's I really wanted to build it in to help in the long run, right? Because I think like a lot of the questions I got was some people would take my tutorial, then try it out, and then they'd find that what I was doing was too basic. So they would try one extra, let's say, like, for example, someone would be in gold, and then they would see my tutorial, and they would see that I don't apply shimmies yet. And then it will come and say, well, I applied shimmies, it was a lot easier for me to rank up in gold. And then I would tell them, you know, that's, I'm glad it worked. It's just the reason why I would leave all things like shimmies till later on is that I wanted to leave it to where it's most useful. Because a lot of the people who come ask me questions, sometimes I would ask them if they have a replay ID. Because some people would come in and say they would take my advice, but they still can't win. So I would take a replay, and when I look at it, I've noticed there are just some key points that they're missing out. For example, maybe they're every time they throw a fireball, they dash in, and they're not even aware of like that they're that habit that they're constantly being predictable every time they do that. So then their opponent would notice that, and then they'll just punish the dash every time. And then they wouldn't know how where to go from this. And then they would say, oh, maybe the tutorial isn't maybe I should ask something else like a shimmy. But meanwhile, there's one basic thing you can correct first. And I think that's kind of what I wanted to tackle with each rank, is trying to get all the basics out of the way and make sure that that you can win with just those basics. And if you can't, that's when you add advanced techniques like shimmies and whatnot to your game plan. If you can't win with just the basics.
Yeah, that's a good point. Something else that I had to learn and force myself to do is reviewing your own matches I didn't see, I don't know if you do or don't talk about it, so I don't want to like claim that you do, but like kind of what you're talking about with identifying, you know, for me, it's very hard to identify what I did wrong in the moment if it's not something very obvious, like, you know, dropping a combo or, you know, missing a whip punish. That's pretty obvious. But how do I know when this person has a read on me? Like, what are they reading? You know, what kind of advice do you have for people who in that situation is like, you know, they're doing tell and they have this very obvious tell. I've seen other people do it too. And I'm like, hey, you do this every single time. You know, how do you help people identify that kind of stuff?
Okay, that's a good question. So I have an idea for a video in the near future where it's I want to explain how to analyze replays. I get that question a lot, where people look at replays but they don't know what to look for. And it's a fair question, right? I mean, a lot of people usually give the advice that to just look at your replays, but if you don't know what you're looking for, it's not going to be useful, right? So the idea I have for explaining it in that video, at least what helped me when I was ranking up and I was looking at my own replays, is one of the most basic things you can do to start off that I noticed that a lot of people don't do, is every time you get hit, you should question it. You should question not only when you get hit, but what led it to that situation that got you that got your opponent, let your opponent get damage off of you, right? So like, for one example, let's say in your replay, you notice that you're constantly in the corner and you're taking a lot of damage in the corner, right? So you may one good question to ask yourself is like, I had one someone request a replay like that, and the whole replay he's in the corner most of the time. And if you were to just look at that and say, let me just question every time I got hit, you're kind of just thrown into a guessing game, because basically in the replay I saw, every time he got up, he had to guess and he kept guessing wrong and he got hit. So then he would say, well, let me just guess better. So then I proposed to him, well, what led to that situation? In fact, you look at the replay I showed that I looked at, he's constantly walking back when he doesn't have to be. And that's one habit I've seen from a lot of people. I've noticed in like the gold to platinum rank, some people who play too defensive, they back themselves into a corner. And then once they're in a corner, now you have to start the guessing game. And it's like from there on, there's not much you can do besides guess, because you've already put yourself in a situation. So I think that's it's not just looking at when you take damage, but what led to that in the first place, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's really hard to identify at first, because when you're not used to looking at your own habits, it's you don't really know what to look for. You kind of just like do things and you don't realize it. And by the time you're taking damage, it's too late. So I think I addressed that actually in the, I think my gold to plat video, that gold is where, at least when I was ranking up again with Sakura on my Smurf, that was the rank where I saw people are most predictable. Either the same frame traps, they don't mix up their offense, they're playing too defensive or too offensive. So then I kind of already have a counter strategy. Because one thing I usually stress is you always want to play opposite to your opponent. I think actually Ceroblast mentioned this a few times on his streams, where if your opponent is playing super aggressive, then you want to play super defensive to counter it, and vice versa. And I think some people overlook that. So they'll see the opponent playing super aggressive, and then they also play aggressive. So then because they're not really playing the reaction game and responding to what their opponent does, they're doing too much when they don't have to. And they usually get jumped on, or they'll get whiff punished when they don't mean to, because they're just too active when they don't have to be. When the opponent's already being active, all you have to do is kind of sit there and just react to what they do. Obviously, it won't always be that simple as you get better, but this is something I've noticed. Like when people are starting to get a good grasp of how to improve from, like, I would say the plat to diamond, and start really playing on that higher level, they don't address that first, and I think that's one of the most important things.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And something else, it's somewhat related, somewhat not, that I think about is, you know, you were talking about doing more than you need to, and not necessarily just like playing over aggressive against another aggressive opponent, but the amount of information that's in a fighting game. There was a really, I think my last guest, Ace of Spuds, had a really good quote. I can't remember who said it. It was like a chess master and my dad. But like, if you look at a beginner, I feel like I'm going to ruin this, but it's, they have unconsciousness. Oh, how do I phrase this? Okay, so basically, a player that knows nothing is just pressing buttons, and they're you know, they don't know what they're doing wrong. And then a player that kind of learns the game, they understand how much they don't know, and so they get kind of overwhelmed by the fact that they don't know all these things. And so it's like, it seems like anything can happen, but as you get better, you start to condense a lot of information and realize in this situation only like three out of five things are going to happen, and this one option is probably the most likely, unless as a wild boy, then you might like wake up DP or something like that. And you just slowly start to chunk all this information together. Like chess, there's a chess analogy that's really good about like all the different pieces on the board and how a chess master will chunk a lot of information into just different formations and possibilities that might happen and eliminating anything that isn't a possibility. Whereas a less skilled player can't really do that. And obviously that comes with experience, but also conscious practice of condensing like information together. Like rather than trying to know all the frame data, is it safe? Is it unsafe? Is it punishable? Or how punishable is it? Or like whose turn is it? You know, condensing that information and making it simpler so that all you have to do is, do I press a button or do I not press a button kind of situation, rather than like a lot of people, I'm one of those people that will get analysis paralysis, where you know too much information, but you don't know how to make it actionable. And I find that very fascinating that some people fall into that category. And I'm wondering, you know, after explaining this, do you see this with some of the people that talk to you, where they have, you know, they feel like there's too much stuff going on, or they have this sense of overwhelm?
Yeah, that's a terrific point. I that's actually also one I wanted to, why I wanted to create this series, because I feel like almost not even just fighting either. I'm like you said, you do martial arts, or even if you do music, there is so much you can learn, and you don't. And I think people who get into fighting games have this idea that they have to start learning everything at the same time, when you really only have to learn what's necessary for your level of play, and then you can go from there. This is really how almost every professional player has started, and how they've how they've improved their play. And I think it also makes it more enjoyable, because you only have a certain amount of things to focus on. So then you can really get good at those few things you focus on. So like in Rookie to Bronze, for example, I only kind of like what you said with the frame data and punishing and making and punishing things that are unsafe. I basically didn't stress frame data at all until about silver to gold rank. Everything before that, I kind of just gave this simple idea where once you block something, if you don't know if it's safe, what you can do is you can just try pressing a button after and see if it hits your opponent. If it does, then you know it's unsafe. And then when you can just go from there. You could say, let's say somebody does like Ken heavy Tatsu in your face, and you want to know if you can do anything after that. If you were to press jab or light kick, you see that connects. And then from there, you can say, well, what can I do from light kick? And you can kind of take that and apply it to almost anything you block when you're playing against somebody. So that's kind of the idea I had with Rookie. And then with every rank, I just improve a little bit on it. So like with Rookie, I just said, well, with Rookie, I just said, okay, if you're blocking something, just use light kick to check if it's unsafe. If it is, that's fine. Then what we can do is when we hit bronze, we can find out what we can link from that. So in bronze, you can do light kick DP. So the basis I had was anytime I felt something was unsafe, I just did light kick. And then if I saw it hit, the next time I'll do light kick DP. And then from there, in the next rank silver, you would go for maybe light kick to EXDP. And you just keep improving little by little on something very specific. Like that's one very specific thing, just to punish something. But obviously, there's so many other things to improve on, like anti-airs and bread and butters. But the way I structured it was every rank, you just improve. So like just little chunks until you get to the big picture, which is usually around like platinum to diamond rank when you have all the basics.
Yeah. And listening to you say that, I was watching the video. I did like how you mentioned those sort of things pretty early on in the Rookie to Bronze series. Is the thought that I have is that it's not really there is no right way to learn fighting games, I've noticed. You know, again, most things are learned traditionally. Almost any craft that I can think of, there's somebody there that can teach you how to do it from beginning, like from newbie to master, or, you know, from novice to master. And with fighting games, there's never, you know, other than tutorials, which even the people who program the games, unfortunately, they're not usually actual masters of it. They're just masters at making the game. Because my degree is in animation and game design, and so I know that most of those people that make games usually have consultants that are good at the game to make it. So it's a very fascinating competitive world that we're in, specifically video games in general. But like fighting games, for me, that's where, you know, close to my heart. There isn't this, you know, everyone's trying to find their own way to teach people. But it's fascinating that we kind of have to create this, you know, people like you who make these tutorials, which, you know, are super helpful for, you know, different kinds of people, and everyone learns differently. But it just makes me think there is no, I'm not going to say there isn't a right way, but there currently, within the game itself, I suppose, isn't a real way to learn the game from novice to actually being, you know, a quote unquote black belt or grandmaster black belt or something like that. It's kind of an interesting thought. I just wanted to share real quick.
Yeah. No, I would agree. I think I mentioned actually some of the early videos. I think the first two I mentioned that. I think it's this tutorial I made is best used with other content. Like Alex Myers has great tutorials. Even Automatic has good tutorials. I think it's good to get different perspectives because you have to find the one that works for you at the end of the day. Because the way I structure this might be too slow for somebody. Maybe somebody just wants to learn advanced techniques and like my gold rank or something. I mean, I think it's definitely true. Everyone learns differently, and I think it's up to us as content creators to try to help people as best as they can, just offer different options. Because at the end of the day, I think we might want more people in the scene, and I think one of the most discouraging things is this is just one genre that you really have to put in the work. And if you don't know how to put in the work, then it's going to discourage you from putting it in the first place because you don't even know where to start. But I think it's like up to us as content creators to really encourage people and say, no, it's not as hard as you think. You just have to boil it down to small things and just go from there. But maybe somebody doesn't want to learn like that. I mean, I found this the most helpful, and I found that there wasn't content specific to like a step-by-step guide on how to improve your play. And like I said, I'm always open to criticism. I think people have said really fair things about it. Like I had someone else even say that this wouldn't work with other characters because Sakura has very specific things she can use. So what I did with that was at the most recent video I made, I had a whole section where I used someone like Laura, and I don't have no idea how to use Laura. So I gave just alternate options. Like for example, for Colleen's Light Claw, which is -4 on block, right? Like Sakura can punish that, but Laura can't. Laura's light kick doesn't work at that range. So the kind of basis I get put out there was if you can't punish something, you can at least take your turn. So like someone can, Laura can block it, and then she can go for a command grab after, and your opponent will probably go on defense there. So that's one option you can do with like a whole different character. So anytime I get good criticism that I think is pretty constructive, I try to improve on whatever video I'm making next. I try to really include that and try to expand on it because I think it's, you know, it's good to constantly improve on how you teach, because teaching for Street Fighter and learning Street Fighter are two very different things. And I think there's a lot of I don't want to say bad advice, but there's definitely some advice out there that just I think it's too soon for a lot of players. And I'm trying to fill in that gap and just say, this is what I think of what you could do better. And maybe people can take it from there. So.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that last point, because a lot of times the professionals aren't always the best teachers, because they have a level of knowledge in the game to where I need to go back and study psychology again, because I've forgotten some of the things. But basically, when you become a master in a certain area, when you are really good, it goes to a different part of your brain than what part of the brain that uses language and talking to other people. So you're literally trying to use a different part of your brain to explain what's happening. But it's like explaining how to breathe, how to make your heartbeat. Like you don't know how to explain it because it just naturally happens. It's like an instinct for people who are at a certain level, like the punks, the taquitos, unless they're actively thinking about it all the time while they're doing it and analyzing it, and they have a teacher's mentality. Like, I guarantee if you have a conversation with Punk, he probably would never be able to explain to you all the things unless you ask him like 100 questions, because he just knows it at a very instinctual level. But then there are people, you know, like you just said, teaching is very much very different from learning it itself. You know, they do complement each other, but they are different things, and you have to look at them a little bit differently as a instructor. And it is very hard. But and then one of the other points that you made about this I really like is it is hard to learn fighting games. And one of the reasons I like that, even though it does discourage people, that part I don't like, I do like it because I think it's a great analogy for life. A lot of times, you know, gamers in general and just other people forget how hard life can be. But, you know, and everything, we want things now. We want the perfect job now. We want money now. We want the perfect person now. But we can't always have that. And it's the same thing with fighting games. You have to take L's in order to start winning. And you have to start looking at what you're doing wrong in order to figure out what you can do right. And for me personally, I absolutely love that. It's a hard lesson, but honestly, if you want to be a winner in anything in life, you kind of have to learn to be resilient, take your losses and figure out what you can do from there.
Yeah, it's. I think what's interesting about fighting game is that it's one of the only genres that there really is no luck factor. It's not, if you compare it to like things like Hearthstone or like a battle royale game. Like with Hearthstone, you have a random factor where you don't know what card you're going to be drawn, or with battle royale, RNG. You don't know what gun you're going to pick up. Right, there's like a whole RNG factor where. With fighting games, it doesn't really exist. I mean, both players have 100% control over the characters they play. So mm-hmm. it's really like a battle of the minds. And I think, because I think I've had a discussion before with a few people about why some people would choose a game like games like Fortnite or Counter-Strike over fighting games. And it's interesting to see what people's reasons for it. And so some of those are like, a lot of these games are team-based. So if you were to lose, you can't entirely blame it on yourself, because there are other people at play. So some people find it easier to blame it on other people. I've heard that. It's because I think some people think that people don't play fighting games because they're too hard. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I can agree with that, because Fortnite and Counter-Strike are incredibly difficult games. I don't know if you ever try to really get good at those, but I can't. I mean, those games have a whole other dimension to think about. Yeah. And it doesn't discourage anybody. I mean, these are some of the most popular games in the world. So, you know, one has to ask, what makes these games so popular over fighting games? And I think one key point is you have to take full responsibility over every loss, and that's just kind of how it is. I mean, besides obviously the nature of online, if you were to play offline versus another player, there really is no excuse from that point. I mean, some people can say that, well, you're playing a higher tier character. It's like, you can also play the same character. So both players are at a fair advantage no matter what. You can just pick a better character at the end of the day. So it's interesting to see like how or what people's reasonings are for it. I don't really know the answer. I think there's a lot of fair reasonings as to why people choose those games over fighting games, but mm-hmm. it's kind of like a I want to say never ending question, because there's just so many reasons. I mean, one of them can be because fighting games have crappy online. I mean everyone who plays online, I mean, knows about the kind of state we're in right now with Tekken and Street Fighter. I mean, these are games that are not very good online, and let's be honest. So
I feel you there.
Yeah, I think that's definitely one thing that could improve to keep the casual, because the casual audience is what pays the bills. I mean, these are the people who, even if they don't play the game for like longevity, they do throw a lot of money into the game. So, you know, how do we keep those players invested? I think one of the best ways is to have good online. If you look at every other very popular competitive game, they all have terrific online dedicated servers. Fortnite, Counter-Strike, I mean, they're all great online games. So it's like, how do we bring that to the fighting game genre? And it's pretty tough. Yeah.
So speaking of good online, a question that I have for you is: what is your thought on this League of Legends fighting game? They have Tom and Tony Cannon who made GGPO.
Yeah, so I think I've actually spoke about that with my Discord recently. So it's one of those things where I think if the online is done right, I think we might be able to put that to rest. So this idea that people play. Games like Fortnite and Counter-Strike over fighting games because they have better online. So if we were to have a fighting game that has almost equally good online and that game blows up, I think we have a pretty good consensus as to why fighting games have not been on the level of other games.
And potential crossplay.
Yeah. I mean, I think online in 2019 is like, when it comes to video games, one of the most important factors. It's even discouraged me from even trying certain games. I know when Sam Show first came out, the online was pretty bad. I don't know if they fixed it recently, but that definitely discouraged me from even trying it, because I already played two games, Tekken and Street Fighter, that don't have great online. So I think if this game were to really capitalize on good online, it really could change the genre. Now if that game comes out, if we see like 6 months, we get down the line, it's still kind of we see the same result. We have a lot of hype and it dies down after. I think we might be able to put that to rest and maybe. Try other reasons as to why fighting games don't pick up as popular as Fortnite and other competitive games. But that's really what I'm most interested to see. It's to see how popular this game becomes if it has good online. Because I think it's a very like underrated thing when it comes to development of fighting games. I don't know what goes on with the development of fighting games, but I feel like online is not given enough attention in a lot of games. And I mean, I don't know. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, I agree. That was one of the things. I worked on a fighting game a long time ago, an indie fighting game. It wound up not getting released. I led a project before it got released, but I don't want to speculate, but I do find it very odd that I don't prioritize that over other things, knowing that fighting game is a very community-based, considering it's a one-on-one base game, and you have to play online in order to get some experience, unless you have a local, which not every person has or wants to do. Sure. I find it very odd that they don't prioritize that over other things, and that they would be willing to release a game that doesn't have, you know, immaculate online. And it's totally doable compared to some of the other fighting game or other games that are out there. So I don't know what the restriction is. That's like, if it's something that they have a restriction on, or they're not spending enough time prioritizing it, or they just are overconfident in their ability to make a game, and they don't think people are going to care. But it's been a continual thing, and it's still happening here in 2019. I don't quite understand why they would do that. But, you know, I love Capcom, but they also do some really dumb stuff.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think I don't know. I mean, I don't really have an answer as to why online is not prioritized. Maybe developers don't see it as important as making the game, I guess. I think it should be on par. Mm-hmm. But again, I think this Riot game will really, you know, it really bring that out. This reasoning behind it, and just to see why. I'm also curious to see because some people have talked about characters for that game, right? What kind of characters are they going to have? Original characters?
Oh, they're going to have their League of Legends roster for sure.
Yeah. I mean,
they might add other characters from like different games, but I they have so many characters that they can use already. Why wouldn't they use those characters?
Yeah, I think because I've talked about that too. With what if they just released the entire league roster? But then I think if they were to do that, if they were to just have all the league characters, I think now begs the question: why play that game over league if you could just play league? Like I'm thinking, what if they make a original? Yeah,
but sorry, go on.
Oh, okay. What if they make their own original characters with like a few league guest characters? And that maybe that might bring people in. The reason why I feel they should go that route is that I don't know if they have the same roster, I don't know if people would choose the fighting game over League, because people are already spending a lot of time on League. So mm-hmm. then why would they go to like a one-on-one League, like game with League of Legends characters? People like, because the idea is you want to bring as many people as you can into this game. People who play or who already play competitive games, people who don't play fighting games, like, as many audiences as you can. And I think if you were to put the whole roster ready, it might discourage people from playing since they already play League. But I don't know. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So, one, I think they should have original characters for sure. Two, I don't know if you know what my job is, but I work at a university, and I do like esports events. And so I work closely with some college students, and we have a League of Legends team. And then we also just have some kids that also love League of Legends. And it's very fascinating because a lot of them are trying to learn fighting games from me because they're getting ready for this League of Legends fighting game. Like some of them have never even played fighting games. I'm like, dude, I've got to play this game when it comes out just because it's League of Legends.
Super so, interesting. Wow.
Yeah. It's very fascinating. You know, these kids are like 10-ish years younger than me, and they're learning League of Legends or learning fighting games like Street Fighter. I taught one kid like M. Bison a little bit because he's like, you know, getting ready for it, but he also likes Mortal Kombat, so he's a little bit more in the know. But then I have people who've never played it. Now they're just talking right now, and kids get excited, and young adults, they get excited, and sometimes they forget about it, but it's just a level of excitement right now of just another League of Legends IP is very fascinating, because you also have card game and you have the shooter, and people are excited about those as well, just because they are League of Legends. You know, they have this whole lore. Look at TFT. TFT is huge as well. And it's kind of like the casual game, but it's super popular. So I think that you will have a lot of people rushing into fighting games that have never really played fighting games before. But also I think you're going to have a lot of fighting game players, like, you know, Chris G, for instance. He plays League of Legends pretty religiously. Yeah,
I've seen that.
And he probably will play this game as well. So I think I think they're going to have characters from the roster. I 100% don't think they're going to release all the characters at once. One, because that would be very unbalanced and hard to do in a timely manner. Two, because it would be against their normal format of how they release characters. I mean, honestly, the best way for a developer and for players to have a game is you have a base amount of characters, and then you slowly release characters, because you can introduce a game, you can balance the game, and you add a new character, then you tweak that character as you go. So usually what you want to do is make them a little bit more OP, a little more overpowered, and then tweak them to the game, hopefully. Like that's kind of the idea. You don't want to nerf them too hard, but you want to make them strong to where, you know, this is kind of a manipulative thing, but people make characters strong a lot of times because you want people to buy that character or to try that character, to buy the skins of that character. So you want people to like that character. Then you slowly nerf them to the rest of the meta of the game. And you just keep doing that. And it keeps the game way more relevant because you have new marketing material. You have new things. You have new skins where you can do a theme when you release that character. And you like all of a sudden you have like Mega Man theme or something crazy. And you release that with the character and maybe a couple of the characters that are related to that, or like, you know, a Noxian character or a Demacian character has, you know, they all have themes or something like that. So I think that's going to be the way they release a character. You can look at almost every single fighting game now that they all do that. And I said this like about 5 years ago on a podcast that most fighting games are going to go the League of Legends route because that's been a very, I'm not going to say that they did it originally, but most League of Legends has been very successful with this, not just in a sense of making money, but in a sense of keeping the game balanced and relevant and exciting for people. So that's what I think about it.
Yeah, I think that's super interesting that so many League players are excited about this. I'm definitely interested to see like what other League players think about the upcoming game, if they even care. And it sounds like they do. So that's super interesting for sure.
Like a Facebook poll or a Twitter poll or something.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. I also think it's really interesting what you mentioned about making characters a little bit overpowered to market them well to keep the game relevant. I never really thought of that. Mm-hmm. I think that makes a lot of sense to keep the game alive for sure. I probably wouldn't mind it as much if patches weren't so spread out, kind of like with Street Fighter V right now. I mean, what was the last patch? Yeah, had? I mean, I can't even remember.
League of Legends has them pretty regularly. I think that's one of the areas that Street Fighter V kind of fails, is I don't think their balances are either done well enough, or like their character releases, like, you know, Falk, Ed, they've had way too many characters that are way too lackluster. Kage, they have a lot of opportunities to make these characters a little bit more on the OP side and then just bringing them back. For some reason, they always play a little bit safe and these characters don't really. Sakura is another great example. People were really excited about Sakura, and all of a sudden, once she came out, all the excitement died down. And, like, you don't really see her online that often.
So, for sure. And I guess, like I said, I never thought of it that way. I think Capcom would do a lot better if they. I'm kind of for that route because I think it's important to keep fighting games relevant and to market characters when they come out. And yeah. I like you said, I think they did a poor job with Sakura because. I also mentioned this in my tutorial too. I think people focus way too much on what character they play in terms of relevance to the rest of the cast when they don't compete. And I actually plan to make a whole video on this because some people ask me, why did I switch from Akuma to Sakura? And it's a good question, right? And it's mainly because I think it, when it comes to video games, I mean, you have to play whatever keeps you invested in the game. And it doesn't matter if you were to choose a high tier that you don't enjoy, you're probably not gonna stick with the game in general because you don't enjoy the character. Which means you don't enjoy the game because you're playing that character the whole time.
Yeah, even though talking about that.
Yeah, I think. But I also think switching from a low tier to a high tier for competitive play is definitely a great idea. But I think you can also learn the game in and out with the character you enjoy first. Like, I don't think you have to start off with a high tier right away if you don't really understand the game. I think picking the character that keeps you invested will help you learn the game. And then when you get to a point where you feel like the game would just be a lot easier, and if you just pick the high tier, then you could definitely do that. And that's kind of what I try to encourage in the last video or in my stream as well, is that that's also kind of the point of this tutorial, is that so like I've even had some people come into my stream and say, hey, I started with the Akuma your tutorial, but I think like he's too high tier to start with a tutorial. And I go, I tell them people all the time that it's really meant to encourage the idea that you can get a pretty far with any character in this game. It's just when you get to the highest level of play, you might, if you feel you want to take a competitive play seriously, then I think switching tiers would definitely help. It's just, I don't think most people are on that level to begin with. And I think they're not spending enough time to get better because the character they play, they don't really like that much. I just feel like they have to play the character because they're high tier or whatever. But if you look at, you know, the majority of the player base, like I said, I think most people play online. So if you're just playing online and just kind of trying to get better online, then you can play whoever you want. I mean, we have Warlord juries. We have some of the highest ranks, some of the quote unquote lowest tier characters. So it doesn't really matter when it comes to online play. It's really just like the highest levels.
Yeah. No, I really resonate with what you're talking about because as a Fong main, I definitely, and I do compete and I play online. So I have found it very I have liked the journey that I've gone through with Fong, and I don't really have any intention of dropping him because I don't really see a need to. But along the way, I decided to just try learning some new characters, and I've tried a few. I've bounced around, and Akuma's who I've most recently settled on. And I actually tried him out in a tournament a while ago. I was in grand finals. I wound up losing, but I tried him out, and I was really satisfied with my performance. But it also made me realize that, man, like, I have to put in way less work and I can get way more results with this character. I never really understood that because I had always worked so hard to get a win with Fong. And every win seems like a hard fought battle. And it's like, I just get in their mind and they just don't know the matchup. That's a way different thing. And that's not really satisfying. It's just, they don't know what to do. I'm just going to take advantage of it. It's a tournament, you know, it sucks to them. But playing as Fong, you know, or playing as Akuma, there is some tier privilege I didn't notice. But I will say, though, I went the route of learning the fundamentals with him. So kind of similar to what you're doing. Like, this is before I came across your video. I think that's after going through this journey with Akuma that I'm still going on. I saw your video from, you know, Reddit on the our Street Fighter.
Yeah.
They tweeted it out, and I was like, wow, that's kind of similar to what I'm doing with Akuma, but I just didn't do ranked. I just kind of, I've just been in a lab kind of practicing fundamentals. And so I'll go online, I'll play matches and casual matches, and I won't really do anything fancy. I haven't practiced meaties. I'll just try to figure out a few things here and there, but I just focus on like my links and my movement and, you know, just simple stuff that I really want to hone. And I'm like, wow, this can take me really far. I have no meaties. I don't really have any crazy setups or anything. And I'm just doing the most simplest of things with this character, and I'm getting it. Now, I'm not trying to restrict myself in the sense of like not doing these things. So I'll try meaties and I'll fail and I'll get like crush countered or something because I didn't time it properly. But then it lets me know that I can't do that thing. And it's been very fascinating looking at this character. I'm like, wow, like I can go really far with this because I still have a character to go back to that I really enjoy. I can go back to a Fong and like, winning with him feels so satisfying when it's like, you know, playing against a Zangief, you know, a character that has way more health than me. I have to beat them using my brain. Really, like, I can't lose focus. If I lose focus, what'll happen is I'll do a random thing and then I'll get V trigger one and I'll have two choices to make right in that, or I lose.
And then you're dead.
Yeah. I literally have two choices. I count it all the time. I have like two people in my locals that play Zangief. So I play against them regularly and I'm not on my A game. If I'm tired or if I'm not focused, I lose for sure. That's all on me. So, and Akuma does have low health. And I haven't fought them against that, but I know the matchup very well with Akuma or Fong, so as long as I'm doing my work, then I'm good. But I do want to segue into the final questions so that I can get you out of here, get back to what you have to do. I want to know, you know, for you, outside of your content, you know, people who want to get better, that maybe either your content doesn't resonate with you or they haven't seen it yet, you know, what advice do you have for them in a sense of getting better at fighting games?
So I think the most important thing over everything is you need to have fun with the game. Before you decide if you want to spend time investing in a game and getting better at it, you got to make sure you enjoy it. I mean, this goes for like any competitive game you play. If you don't enjoy the game, you're not going to want to spend the time. It's just, it's what it comes down to at the end of the day. So you have to find what makes the game fun for you. If that means playing Ryu, one of the worst characters in the game, then that's what it's going to be at first. Because like I said before, you can always switch tiers later on. I mean, well, once you have a good understanding of how the game is played, you can always change later on. I mean, nothing's really stopping you. But I think a lot of people don't focus on how much they enjoy the game first. I think NDZ Jimmy actually had a good segment on one of his streams one time where because a lot of people come in and ask him personally and also me as well what they should do first when learning Street Fighter. And I always tell them, you want to spend a good amount of time playing with anybody you know who already has the game and just, you know, mess around in Battle Lounge, just like play around with the game, you know, toy around different characters, see what you like. And then when you've like decided that this is a game you enjoy, then you can start taking it more seriously. But I don't think enough people focus on the first part. So they start playing, you know, a character they don't like for a game maybe they don't even realize they don't like. And then they spend all this time getting good at a character, trying to get good at a game, and then they ended up hating it later on. And then, you know, these are the people you see in Twitch chats who complain about the game all the time. I feel like these are the people who don't realize that maybe they just don't like the game. And maybe you shouldn't have started to begin with. So I think it's important to Not only try to enjoy the game you're playing, but try different games too. Because I mean, every fighting game is different. Mortal Kombat, it's totally different from Tekken and Street Fighter and Samsho. All very different games. So you always want to find the one that you would think you have the most fun playing, and then you can play around with characters, play with friends, and then pick the one you like. And then you can start, you know, investing in getting better at the game. But it really starts with the first part. I don't think enough people spend enough time on it.
And then what motivates you to keep playing fighting games?
I guess, for one, I think it's creating content. I think I'm creating content for this because there's not a lot of it compared to other categories. So I think I can really get creative with my ideas because a lot of it hasn't been done before, right? So I can really sit down and think about, well, what kind of value can I add to this community? Because it's still kind of niche. I hope it would, you know, explode one day, but you know, it's for now, it's still like a small, you know, a small piece of the internet, a small piece of video games. So it's fun to make content for a community that's not on that scale yet. So for one, it's content. And two, I think it's a sense of community. I don't really see this kind of community with other video games. I mean, I don't know. Does Fortnite and Counter-Strike have the same kind of community and events that Street Fighter does? I mean, because I've been traveling, I want to say, for 2 years now to Evo, to Combo Breaker, and a bunch of different tournaments. And one of the things I've noticed is it's very different in person. I mean, everyone's kind of there for the same reason. And because it's like a one-on-one fighting game, it's like the experiences you have with people are very different than like team-based fighting games, right? So like you don't even have to go to compete half the time. Half the time I go to these events, it's really just to socialize with people and get to know other people who play the game. And that really expands in the community. So I would say content and community, those two factors are really big. And maybe partially competitive. I don't really compete as much anymore. I used to go to my local at Next Level in New York City every Wednesday. I haven't gone in some time, but I definitely want to reinvest in there at some point. I just got a new job and whatnot, but I think that's probably the third reason, even though I haven't really taken it as seriously lately. But the competitive nature is also very different too, because it's just the fact that it's two people, it changes the whole dynamic from, say, like Fortnite or a team-based game. It changes everything in terms of community, in terms of content, and that's really what keeps me going when it comes to, you know, playing these mainly Street Fighter, but just fighting games in general. So.
All right, well, I appreciate that. The last question, speaking of content and community, is what do you have coming up and where can people find you?
So right now on at twitch.tv/Ceelows, right now on my stream, I'm basically taking my own advice and trying new characters. I've been streaming ranked for quite some time now, and I'm kind of tired of the whole, I'm kind of tired of just streaming ranked for the hell of it. I want to have some structure to it. So I want to take my own advice and try my own tutorial with multiple characters. So right now I'm doing Jury. I eventually want to do Falk, Sagat, and maybe Ryu. I haven't really thought about it yet, but those are the characters that are on my list right now in terms of my stream. And with YouTube, I want to have different content on YouTube. So youtube.com/Ceelows is where you can find my YouTube. And my YouTube, even though right now it only has tutorials, I do want to get into specifics, right? So right now I have a video I'm working on where I test out Sakura's light DP as an anti-air exclusively and how it compares to her other anti-airs. So I really want to get into the specifics of certain characters like that. And then eventually, what I really want to do on YouTube is get into more personal ideas when it comes to fighting games. So for example, I have one idea where I want to make a video on what it's like to stream fighting games in 2019 on Twitch. Because for example, streaming Street Fighter is very different from streaming Fortnite. And the way you kind of grow an audience on Twitch is very different from YouTube. And I think it's important to let people know what it's like to stream a niche like Street Fighter. Because usually what I've noticed is it's really good to combine the two when you do YouTube and Twitch. Usually you can bring people over from YouTube onto Twitch because Twitch isn't really a discoverable platform, if you notice. It's kind of like you pick a category, you pick the top five streamers, and you watch those people. But with a niche like Street Fighter, I've I've grown most of my community on just streaming on Twitch and just a little bit of Twitter. And I think it's definitely possible with a niche like Street Fighter. So I kind of want to make some content on that subject, because I don't think it gets enough attention. Because there's a lot of people who want to start not just playing fighting games, but they want to create content for it too. And I think it's different. It's a different way to approach it than the typical way, like streaming Fortnite or something. So that's like the future of my YouTube channel. And for Twitch, I'm really just taking my own advice for now, different characters. But again, that's twitch.tv/Ceelows, and the same thing for YouTube.
All right. Well, there you have, ladies and gentlemen. Again, Ceelows, thank you for joining me on the show. It's been a very good conversation. So that said, all the information that he just said will be found in the show notes down below or in the description if you're listening to this on YouTube. Again, my name is Philosopher. Thank you guys so much. And as always, I will see you all in the next one. Thank you.